Well, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Jason Kush from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, in the U.S. I teach at Slippery Rock University, which is a state institution in Pennsylvania. Also, teach at Carnegie Mellon University in the city of Pittsburgh. Really excited to be here. This is my first time at the World Saxophone Congress, so this is for everyone else. Is it a repeat time? Second time? Third time?
Tenth
time? Okay. Okay, well, I'm happy to be here and I'm already looking forward to the next one. Today I'm going to talk with you about something I'm very, very interested in. This is Francois and his totally amazing invention called the Aulochrome. We'll talk also about some of his other inventions as we proceed through the topic. This is a very current topic. All involved parties with this are still around. Francois still resides in Belgium. All the people that I interviewed for this project are still with us. So it's very much still a current project. Because of that, some of the things that I encountered with this included trade and design secrets of Francois Louis, sensitive personal information, which I promised him I would not share, and legal issues pertaining to his career and to the Aulochrome also, which play a role in this, but won't really be covered in my lecture today for obvious reasons. I want to make sure that this lecture is something that is not too boring. So if you have any question about anything, please just say, hold on a second, or could I explain something a little bit more? I know we have some, everyone's speaking some English, some people a little less, but if I can explain something more, please let me know. I'd rather cover things that everyone understands than just me just talk and put everyone to sleep over the course of my hour. Okay. So to give you an introduction, what we're going to talk about in a little bit, I'll play you a little bit of the sound of the Aulochrome. But before I do that, how many have heard of this thing called the Aulochrome before? How many have seen it? Seen it? Okay, a little bit. All right. So it's a very unique instrument. You can see it in the background in the picture. In my next slide, I'll play you a little bit, and we'll listen to the sound of this. One instrument. For this project, I also met with Joe Lovano, a great jazz tenor saxophone player. In fact, in this photo on the right, I'm in his home playing the Aulochrome there. I interviewed several saxophonists that Francois Louis worked with during his career, among which are the Italian saxophonist Emanuele Cisi, French saxophonist Francois de Berge, and American saxophonist Tim Rees. 2009, I published my dissertation on this from the University of Miami. However, because of all this information being very brand new and everyone sort of clinging to the intellectual property of this information, I wasn't able to publish it on the internet. So, you can, unfortunately, like many dissertations, we can go and look up. Mine you cannot, because the contributors would not sign off on the publication of it because of the very new nature of the information here. Also, my project basically collects the information together. Francois Louis told me about his invention. I translated a lot of things that he gave me, but I have invented. None of this is my invention. None of it. I will not take credit for any of it. But putting these things together. So some background on this man, Francois Louis, pictured there with the Aulochrome in his backyard in Ciclay, Belgium. He was born in 1954 to a regular middle-class family. His dad was an engineer of sorts. His mother was a teacher of English, I believe. Like Adolf Sachs, he had many things, peculiar things happen in his early life due to his curiosity with how things work. What makes this work? As we know, Adolf Sachs had many near-death experiences, right? All of these fell out of the door and drank iodine and all these things. He almost died several times. Also, Francois Louis, also a Belgian, same thing. He wanted to experiment with conducting electricity, so he had a hanger, metal hanger, and he sticks it in here and had to go to the hospital and electrocuted. He also was experimenting with the stove in the kitchen, with the gas, how much gas to make a fire. He blew up his whole kitchen and had a huge house fire due to that. He also, as a child, built a crystal radio, which you could get a package in order to build a radio. And with this radio, would later change his life. We'll talk about that in a little bit. The radio that he built allowed him to hear American jazz, which was broadcast from armed force bases. So it was a armed forces radio which played big band American jazz, and he heard this as a child and loved the sound of this music, which was unusual in Europe at this time. Totally different than this, he was a motorcycle mechanic, very interested in running and racing motorcycles, building motorcycles, and that was his main source of income. He didn't start as a musician. Through high school, many of us like working on saxophone and whatever. He was very interested in the arts, but was not a musician at all. He transferred between different trade schools, sort of just like a wandering personality. He wants this, now he wants this, now he wants this, now he wants this, all these different things. Come on in, please. There's a handout in the back. Please take a handout. Thank you for joining us. So, Francois Louis is a dramatic person inside. He needs some drama in his life. So one day, he was, it occurred to him that he had some money in his bank account. He had a very good girlfriend. He had a steady income. He had a refrigerator filled with food, as he said. And he felt like in his early 20s, his challenge for life was already met. So he decided, no girlfriend, I'm moving out. I'm not fixing motorcycles and racing motorcycles anymore. So he moves out and decides, I really want to be an artist. I'm going to be an artist. And this is really unusual for all of us, right? Because we've built to this our whole life. He decides, I want to be an artist. So I'm going to play the saxophone. I always liked music. I'm going to play the saxophone. So he goes to the music store to start his artist career at the age of 23 or 25 or so. And they said, well, which saxophone do you want? At this time, he was not aware that there was different saxophones. He didn't know it was alto and tenor and baritone. He said, yeah, no, it's just like this one. Like this one. So they, oh, you want tenor. You want a tenor saxophone. So this man, Francois Louis, knew nothing about the saxophone in his mid-20s at all. He knew nothing at all. Before getting into the saxophone, he was experimenting with making his motorcycles go as fast as possible so to win the races and to have happy customers in his motorcycle shop. And with that, he was experimenting with fluid dynamics through the motorcycle chamber. And this is something, the chamber of the engine of the motorcycle. It's something I don't understand or know about. But as he explained it to me, the way that the shock wave moves through the chamber of the motorcycle is the same way the air, the vibrating air column, moves through the mouthpiece. He found this parallel with it, which is going to be very important here in a moment. So, Francois Louis is very curious about this. How does the mouthpiece work? He's not a good saxophonist. He studied, do we have anyone here from Western Europe? He studied with Bernard Longchamp, and a Belgian guy, I guess, who was taught a lot of folks, at the academy, music academy, eventually, when he decided to be an artist, in Brussels. So, one day, he takes his Selmer mouthpiece and he fills it with epoxy. It's no more mouthpiece, and he decides, I'm going to make this thing more efficient. I'm going to make it operate better than it was before. So he fills it with epoxy, fills it with plastic or material inside, full mouthpiece, and then he takes his files and creates a new chamber inside the mouthpiece. And he knows nothing. He has only seen one mouthpiece ever, his mouthpiece. So he has a real mind for mechanics and how things work. So around 1981, he started to make mouthpieces out of wood and making his own mouthpiece. And the Count Basie Orchestra came through Brussels and played, and the saxophonist Billy Mitchell had a terrible thing happen where he dropped his saxophone, and it was the day of the concert. Francois Louis was working at a music store, fixing instruments. Billy Mitchell came to the store and said, can you fix this instrument? And Francois Louis, it was dropped. And so he just fixed it by switching the direction of the fall. He twisted the instrument just back into place. So Billy is there and says, I want to try that what is that weird mouthpiece you have there? And this is the birth of Francois Louis as a known mouthpiece maker in 1981, when he only had made a couple of mouthpieces. As you see, this one is made out of rosewood, and in lead, he writes to Billy. So it's not a good thing to put on, that's something we put in our mouth. But so he made this mouthpiece for Billy Mitchell. Billy Mitchell goes back to the United States, and everyone in New York is like, man, Billy, what is this mouthpiece? I want one of these mouthpieces. And one of the main people who wanted this mouthpiece was Joe Lovano, great saxophonist Joe Lovano, comes to Europe and seeks out Francois Louis for a mouthpiece. Around this time, Francois Louis patented his special mouthpiece design. I wish I could point to it. As you can see here, this is a copy of the original Belgian pad. You see here from the side, it is a circular chamber, spear chamber, meaning that it is rounded from all sides, not just top and bottom or left and right. There's like a ball shape inside the chamber. And you see here from the top, also, spear chamber there. His idea with this was that any frequency would resonate within here, rather than some frequencies resonating. So you take a mouthpiece that does not have a spear chamber, and the sound is different. It's still good. Probably everyone in this room plays a mouthpiece that has a regular chamber, maybe a square chamber or a round chamber, But his design is unique to a spherical chamber. So the chamber gets smaller before it goes into the tube of the saxophone. That's the unique thing. So the very also very famous thing is Francois Louis make very big tip openings. Tip, very big. So Joe Lovano says, can you copy, make me one just like my Autolink 10 star? And so Francois Louis finds out, okay, 10 star, so big, he makes it for Joe Lovano. Joe Lovano comes back 1 year later and he gives him the mouthpiece. It's way too small. Finds out that Joe Lovano's 10 star was actually bent open to 12 star, 150 thousandths of an inch. So like a huge, huge mouthpiece opening. So Francois Louis started making these mouthpieces which were easy to play. Very, can you imagine a 10 or a 12 or a 14 size mouthpiece? Easy to play. And Joe Lovano used number 4 reed. So these mouthpieces are very, very efficient. Very, very, very efficient. Here's another picture of his mouthpieces. This is from his 1987 patent, which he renewed. And you can see this very clearly, the shape of the sphere inside of the mouthpiece. Here's some pictures of later, he started interacting with more American saxophonists because everyone in New York wanted one of these mouthpieces. So just to name some names for you. Bob Berg. How many have heard of Bob Berg? Yeah, this looks just like Bob Berg's mouthpiece. Exact same thing as Bob Berg's mouthpiece. Bob Berg, Dave Liebman, Tim Rees, Dick Oates, Ralph LaLama, Chris Potter, Billy Drews, Emanuele Chisi, and Ronnie Cuber. All were playing his mouthpieces. And again, I haven't named a classical saxophonist. He's playing these large, he's making these large volume, loud, big mouthpieces. Okay? So he was making them soprano, alto, tenor, and baritone, and in wood, as well as solid silver. So as you can see, this mouthpiece here is cast from solid silver, a lost wax casting from solid silver. The only way you could get his mouthpiece was to call him, and he would say, he doesn't do mail order, like, oh, I like this tip opening, this facing. No. You had to go to his shop, play for him, tell him I'm listening to Train, I'm listening to Stan Getz. I want to sound like Train and Stan Getz. And this is what I like. And he'd say, okay, I'll call you. And maybe it'd be like a year, and he'd call you. He charged $600 for a mouthpiece. And this is, we're talking like in the 1990s, this is like a lot of money for a mouthpiece. These mouthpieces now, if you can find them on eBay, about $3,000 for his handmade mouthpieces, if you can even find them. Because about this time, he started working with Fabrizio Cassol, who I previously mentioned, the Belgian saxophonist Fabrizio Cassol. They were talking about an instrument which could create two sounds. Fabrizio came to him and said, hey, Francois, can you make this instrument with two sounds? It was similar to, his conception was similar to a melodica that could be played like two melodicas like this, with different reeds for every sound, which got Francois thinking of a new instrument. This is in the late 1990s. Fabrizio Cassol told Francois Louis about possibly getting funding through an organization called Brussels 2000, which was a Brussels organization which promoted the arts, and they were trying to create new things for the millennium. So a terrible thing happened in 1989. Actually, these are the mouthpiece. You can see how it goes down inside. Here's the chamber, and it gets smaller before it goes into there. This, I don't know if anyone has this album. This album was probably the first time Francois Louis' mouthpieces were recorded. Joe Lovano came back from getting his mouthpiece from Francois Louis, and this next day played this session. And he plays on the tune Interloper on this very famous Melville's orchestra. I love this album. Anyone check this album out? No one knows this one? It's a good one. Very good. Here's a picture of Francois Louis and Fabrizio Cassol around the time of the invention of the Aulochrome, which we're not there yet. So, a terrible thing happened in 1998. Francois Louis lost everything he owned, except for about $200 American. He had left to go to the US, and someone called him, or somehow he found out that his home was on fire. He lost 10 Mark VI saxophones. He lost all of his records, his measurements for every mouthpiece that he had ever created for anyone by 1998. He lost his casings for the solid silver mouthpieces. So at that time, he could not create any more of those things anymore, complete and total loss. And he had no money and no records at all. So the Jazz Society of Brussels got together and did a fundraiser concert for him because he was very much a friend of the community. They raised some money for him, but he was still basically starting his career over with no resources, no machinery, no files, no anything. It's really a terrible time. But it was about this time, shortly after this, that he got approved for funding for creating this instrument called the Aulochrome. I believe that he had asked for something along the lines of a couple €100,000. And when his proposal came back, they offered him to create this instrument €700 a month for 18 months. So it's a very small amount of money to even just live on and pay your bills. And this is to pay for his resources, his research, the purchasing of the tubes, everything. So he had €700 a month for 18 months. So he ended up going into a pretty terrible debt over creating this instrument. In fact, he told me that he thought he had about €200,000 into the creation of the Aulochrome. He did also get some funding from Brussels 2000. Also, Philippe Bosemans, from Belgian composer, offered to write a piece, basically a classical saxophone type of piece with orchestra for the premiere. And also, Sylvain Camberling, a former conductor from the Baden-Baden and Freiburg Symphony Orchestra of Germany, offered to contribute financially for the creation of this new thing. He worked on the Aulochrome from July of 99 until December of 2000. He basically ran out of time. There were things on the instrument which were never created. For instance, you can see that actually it is keyed down to low A, and also only goes up to high D, and there's only one side D key with it. So he ran out of time. He was also supposed to create two of these instruments, one which was to remain a model. Nobody plays it. It's kept as a preserved model, and one that Fabrizio Cassol would play and learn to play. But because of his money limitations and his time limitations, he was only able to create one of it. It's an unlacquered instrument also. It's really only created as a prototype. It's not really made to be played a lot. And I'll start to pass this demonstrative around. I have this printed. Some time to do this. This is almost about exactly the size. It's about maybe a half inch too big. But this is about how it is. And it's curved up here, as you can see, and there's a curve down here, like this. But we'll pass it around, give you an idea of playing this instrument. And also on the back, you can see the thumb keys there. So, where did he get this idea to create this instrument which creates two sounds? And it not only creates two sounds, but maybe it creates three sounds, four sounds, five sounds, depending on the acoustic environment that's happening. Maybe some of you have had an experience with two flutes or two piccolos playing together, or two soprano saxophones, or two alto saxophones in the upper register. We have these interesting sounds that we hear, which are just more than two notes. Which happened, right? It's an acoustic principle called the difference tone or the sum tone. This is sort of the origin of it. The alos, which is basically a reeded instrument, double reeded instrument possibly, that someone would play to create two sounds. And this, obviously, from very, very, very long time ago. I'm trying to find a year. So, and the sounds that would be created, the double sounds, or the three sounds, the combination tone, difference tones, they thought that way back in Greek times, that sound, those special sounds were special for fertility. So you see this, that he's chasing her around, playing these sounds, trying to get her in the mood to, you know, produce. So before creating the allochrome, it's not just about creating these two sounds which could create three and four and five sounds. Francois Louis wanted to actually reinvent the mechanism on the saxophone, the keys. He wanted to reinvent the keys on the saxophone. So first what he did in order to do his research is he made a soprano saxophone using his new method for the key work. Can you imagine a soprano saxophone that weighs as much as a flute? This would be nice, right? Alto saxophone that weighs as much as a soprano. His method cut down on the weight of the instrument considerably. I'll show you that more specifically here. Here's another zoom in. This is a very raw instrument, as you can see, his solderings and everything. And this was just sitting on a desk in his house. Even at the top, you can see there's just corks. He never made the high D, no palm keys on this thing, but he wanted to check and see how to make this new mechanism. Do you see how this is different here than what we use? This is part of his patent on this new instrument. You can see it's much different. The way these connect to the key cups here is different. And this is the revolutionary mechanism. You can see here the different parts. On the left side, you see the instrument, the mechanism put together. Here, you have a triple access point. This triple access point, which you see broken down over here, allows you with one screw to adjust the key cup like this, also like this. So you imagine your, say for instance, your low D key, it's kind of got a little leak on it. Instead of like heating up that pad and receiving the pad, you could just change that triple access screw and just loosen it, put it down, and tighten it back up. And this would totally revolutionize how us as individuals could adjust our saxophones. Also, you can independently, as you can see, with this, the way the key cup comes out, say you want to change just the low D key, loosen that screw, take out just the key. Replace the pad, put it back in. No more connecting rods which house all of the keys. You know, when we take one of our rods out, it takes up like half the saxophone, right? Oh, sorry. The other thing is that he used stainless steel posts and rods, which are all hollow. Some bars on the saxophone are solid. Many of them are solid, with just holes for the screws on the tops and bottom. Everything is hollow, thereby making it much lighter weight. And also, you can feel the instrument buzzing in your fingers. You can feel the vibration because all of those tubes being hollow are resonating with the sound of the note that's being played at the time. It's just wonderful, wonderful ideas. Fabrizio Casol at this time was experimenting with the instrument. I have another recording of it here. I'll play it for you in a second. Give you an idea of the things we're talking about.
Thank you.
So sometimes the intervals are not in tune. It's a very challenging thing about playing the instrument. When you have all these different intervals, you want to tune them to make sure that they're not sounding out of tune, right? But with the notes being out of tune, so one note's maybe sharp, like 3 cents, you get the beating sound, sound in the tone. Is that making sense? The beating of the sound, which creates that low note way down below what you're actually playing. So here's a picture of the first mouthpiece set that he made. It was from two Summer saxophone mouthpieces that he got, but he created two chambers for each of them. One has a slightly smaller chamber, and the other is larger, as to give both sides a personality. So one sounds like a little more edge, and one sounds a little bit darker. Mouthpieces were shaved in the middle, and then with epoxy glued together, with one common ligature and obviously two soprano saxophone reeds. As you can see here, this one has a slightly larger chamber, a little more space here, this one higher. And this center area is kind of raised so that you can put the reeds against it, which would make it easy to keep the reeds in place. Here's a bottom shot of the Aulochrome. This was the first case. Francois Louis made this case from a viola case. A viola case. But since Joe Lovano had it, this guy, I forget his name, out in San Francisco made a custom case for it. Here you can see, and with the demonstrative, you can see that the keys are each split, similar to like our low C and E flat keys, is every key. So you have top side operates the right tube, and the bottom side operates the left tube. Okay? So if you want to play G and B, you will play double, and then top, G and B. Or if you want to go unison, GG to GB, okay? So it's kind of like, you can't play like a two-part invention with this instrument. I hate to say, Francois Louis would disagree. He said, you can play anything with this instrument. He's very passionate about it, but it's more like a guitar, where you can play like some single note lines and then occasionally harmonize along the single note line. So you could take and play, let's say D and A. So it'd be D on the top, double, and then top, D and A. Okay? For both. Then it gets tricky on the back, because technically you could play a high C and a low D if you want. It's very hard though, because the pressure on the reed, you know, if you want a high note on one side and a low note on the other side, it's very difficult. When I had the chance to play this thing, and Joe Lovano currently, I believe that Joe has this. I spoke to Francois back in October, and he said that he had the instrument at his home. Because again, it's not really made to be played a lot, and Joe Lovano's taking this thing all around the world and playing it. And playing hard, and so it goes out of alignment. So he'll play it for like 6 months, and then he'll give it to Francois Louis for 6 months. And then he gets it back, and then Francois, you know, just back and forth. But the shame is that it's really not meant to be playing. It's bare brass, so it's all has like rust on the thing. It's in pretty bad shape. Even you see the high D key up here. This is the high D key. It's the only palm key. And it only is on the right side, I believe. I think it only operates the right side. And Joe actually snapped it off. It broke. So I think it doesn't have it anymore. No more D on it. You can see on the back. That's your right hand thumb keys. Left side. And it goes to low A, but there's no key. He wasn't able to make any key for it. He just ran out of time to put the linkages in to make the low A key work. Ligature, And you can see here how it's a kind of, you see some rust in there. It's very big, as you can see with this. It's kind of like, it's a lot to hold. This is very confusing here too. These are split keys. Everything is split here. So you have G sharp split in half there. And then these keys, that's for the left side, right side is over here. So it's like a bassoon. Cindy, still doing some bassoon? And that's, yeah, that, this is just confusing. If you want to play like C and E flat, it's going to be challenging, but possible. This is an interesting thing that he made. He wanted to, Francois is very forward thinking. And in his last conversation with me, I have a kind of a quote from him. He told me, "I'm not sure I'll ever be able to commercialize it in my lifetime. I know you're supposed to never give up, but sometimes I'm just a bit exhausted." So he's had some problems, some surgeries and so forth. He's busy with his creation of the ligatures and running the, he still makes mouthpieces, production mouthpiece. I recently had a line of silver, new silver mouthpieces that, or bronze, I believe. Mouthpieces that came out. So he doesn't have the goal, I would say, of producing this in his lifetime. But I think he was thinking beyond his lifetime to think that maybe someone would want to do this. So he worked with Francois de Court, also known in Belgium, to put together a 3D imaging model of this so that every single specification of every single key was exactly correct and it could be reproduced. If someone had the details in this. And by creating the model, they could also make these interesting videos here. I'll show you. Well, it's kind of interesting. This takes you on a little ride through the Aulochrome keyword, anyway. Starting at the mouthpiece there, you can see how it's filed on the sides. And of course, the body tube is not there. There's the D key. And you can see all the linkages at the top. So here I created a fingering chart, which I basically explained it already. Again, some things are would be very hard to do with a lot of speed on it. Again, it's not really designed to do like a two-part invention sort of duet in that sort of way. It's basically just one sound with some harmonization. You can see there's even bis, left and right side bis keys as well. Here's a soundbite from the premiere, which was at Radio France. And the piece, from what I understand, was a really interesting piece, and the audience was sort of waiting in great anticipation. You imagine sort of like the beginning of the saxophone being out there. We're hearing about this thing, and they want to hear what this is going to sound like the very first time. But the orchestra played with such finesse, and here comes this kind of like instrument that is not so gentle. So you'll hear it a little bit. Thank you. interested in this thing. In the US, everyone's hearing about it. Everyone wants a little bit of a taste of it. Fabrizio Cassol and Francois Louis worked on this a lot. Francois is a good saxophone player and it's a very nice sound, but he's not a guy that has spent a lifetime preparing to be a performer on the saxophone. So he wanted someone who's really well-versed in the saxophone to work on this. So that's why Fabrizio Cassol was involved. Fabrizio did a lot of work on this, gave Francois some input of, okay, maybe this key should be more like here, or it'd be helpful if I had this, or whatever. So he would have it for a little bit, and give it back to Francois, and they worked on it together a lot. This is where sort of the legal trouble comes in, where it's my understanding that Fabrizio felt some ownership towards the instrument due to his input on it. However, Francois' craftsmanship and design was all his. So there became a legal battle for this. That's basically all I'll say about that. But you can see in this picture here that Tim Rees, Michael Brecker, everybody's favorite, Fabrizio, you know, they're all hanging out. Fabrizio, he's got a little hand on it, right? He's got to have a little piece of it. Here is the very first time that Cindy, you might have been there. When did you graduate?
2006.
There you go. So this is the first U.S. demonstration of the Aulochrome, March 2005. That is University of Miami, good old Bander. Francois Lamine came there as a friend of one of our faculty members down there and presented it. So it's the first time that he had brought this instrument there. And I was a graduate student at that time and had no idea that I would end up doing all this research on this thing, and I happened to have taken a picture that day, and this is the picture of it, so it's sort of foreshadowing. And Cindy Cripps, who was in school with me at that time, you might have, did you go to this?
I don't know.
Yeah, it was a long time ago. You might have, let's just say you were there. You were there. This is, do you remember Randy Emmerich? He fixed instruments. He had like on the bass saxophone, the contra saxophone.
Okay.
Everyone was way into it. So here, Lovano, my man, on the Aulochrome. Let's check out what he's doing. Imagine you can actually play it as just one saxophone over here, just single soprano, and then back in. Does that on practice this thing a lot. You can't pick this thing off and play it. You can give an alto to like some fifth grader and show them some stuff and they'll sound okay. This thing, when I tried it, I was like squeaking and like air is coming out. It's very difficult to play. So what he's just like, imagine, just like all the other instruments he plays, he's a master. Joe's album Folk Art, which I recommend getting. He also plays it a couple of tracks on this. This is actually the very first time it was recorded. His album is Dreams and Expression. Also on the second Us Five record, Cross Culture. It's a good one. And the last thing, any questions? I hope I didn't bore you as a fear. Any questions about the Aulochrome? How many Aulochromes are there? One. There's only one, yeah. Francois Lully didn't invent this for Joe Lovano, however Joe has played it more than anyone in the US. There is, I always want to try to dispel the rumors with this lecture a little bit. Some people say, oh yeah, he's gonna make one of those, he's gonna make them and whatever. There's no plan for it to be produced at all. There was some hope of that. But it would require completely retooling a factory in order to make the new mechanism for this. And it would just be extremely cost prohibitive. I mean, he would have to pre-order 20 of these at, you know, $40,000 each or something like that. It would just be ridiculous. Although I think there are a lot of people out there that would cough up the money to have a chance at the newest member of the saxophone family here at the Aulochrome. Thanks for listening. If you have any questions, please stick around. The paper that you all took is from the very first program in Paris for the Aulochrome at its premiere. So you can read Francois Louis' description of the Aulochrome. So just check that out. Check that out. Question? Yes?
Is it different mouthpiece or different saxophonist or the same mouthpiece?
This one?
Yes.
He made this one for Fabrizio.
Yes.
When Joe got it, he told me, man, this thing's too small, because he plays all these big mouthpieces. Yes. So I believe that Francois made one, a bigger one for Joe.
Yeah. And the sound is completely different.
Yeah, completely different. Yeah. I think though, I didn't play the earliest recordings. The earliest ones, he was playing this mouthpiece on it, the sound. And he's just like, oh man, this thing is too, too close. Yeah, too close for it. Because you really gotta like, you know, you're getting two waves to respond with one airstream. It's a really weird thing. But I would say this thing, like, any of you would just have a blast playing, have so much fun playing this instrument, because it's just like, the sound's like, it's huge, huge sound. Even just playing like this, it's amazing. The resonance of this horn has. Any other questions real quick? All right, thank you everybody.
Thank you.